The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Pain and Torture. Aren't we supposed to take up our cross? No. I have no idea why, but this is going to be a review. I almost called it part three, a review. We're getting a lot of feedback on the last two messages on Zadok, the Zadok priesthood. And so I think what I want to do is, for those that were not good note takers, we have an opportunity to put some of that information on the board so that you can take better notes. Last Sunday, I just kind of shot from the hip and was taking bits and pieces, and Jennifer couldn't follow me. So if Jennifer couldn't follow me, I'm going, we're in trouble. All right? So I figured, you know what? I think it's an important enough message because this message actually preached to Jennifer and I, really, as we were laying this message out and feeling like I was saying there was one particular part that felt like a mandate, and that was that one of the elements in this message was about teaching discernment. And I feel like God's really laid that on our heart, that it needs not to be taught as a topic, but taught people how to do it in a very practical way. So eventually we're going to get to that. But that's the way, you know, when you preach to yourself as well. All right? And so God gives a message, and then he says, and I want you to develop that, just the way it spoke to your heart, and it'll speak to other people. So let me start by reading that portion of Scripture. Ezekiel 44, approximately verses 15 to 28. Ezekiel 44, 15 to 28. And these were the five elements. I'll put this on the board because I jump around. I have a 1, 2, 3, 4, and a 1, 2, 3, and a 1, 2, 5, 6, and a 1, 2, 3, and all over the place. And when I preach it and you're taking notes, good luck. And my favorite thing to do is say, I've got five elements and give you four. And if that doesn't frustrate you, you have to learn to drop down, let it go. Usually I cover the material, but I don't give the little number. And then everybody goes, tilt. So today I'm going to give you, tonight's going to be by the number. Isn't that nice? But anyway, Ezekiel 44, 15 to 28. I'm going to read it to you and pull out the elements that I feel were significant. It says, but the priests, the Levites, the sons of Zadok, who kept my charge of my sanctuary when the children of Israel went astray from me. Interesting. They shall come near to me to minister to me, and they shall stand before me to offer me the fat and the blood, says the Lord God. They will enter my sanctuary, and they shall come near to my table to minister to me, and they shall keep my charge. They shall have linen turbans on their heads and linen trousers on their bodies. They shall not clothe themselves with anything that causes sweat. And they shall teach my people the difference between the holy and the unholy, and cause them to discern between the clean and the unclean. And in controversy, they shall stand as judges and judge it according to my judgments. That's according to his judgments. They shall keep my laws and my statutes in all my appointed meetings, and they shall hallow my Sabbaths. It shall be in regard to their inheritance. I am their inheritance. And you shall give them no possession in Israel, for I am their possession. All right. These are the five elements that I got out of that. Minister to me. These are they who will minister to me. And in the part one, I spent 90% of the sermon just on what that meant. The second element is I saw in that portion spiritual authority. And that's spiritual authority as opposed to positional authority or a title. Okay? The third thing that stood out was that they would both have and teach. And this is the part that preached to us, hon Jennifer. Discernment. They would both have it and they would teach discernment. The fourth element was that they would find, and I'm talking a supernatural component here, they would find satisfaction in him. He would be their portion. Like Abraham said, for the Lord was my exceedingly great reward. They would find their satisfaction in him. Their possession was not in a physical blessing. Their possession was, they're going to find a satisfaction in me. I will be their inheritance. I will be their portion. Okay? So the fifth element I saw was adjudication. And it was just, adjudication just means to rule. And we know under the new covenant, we were in, particularly in Romans 5:17, where it says, you shall reign as kings in life through the one, Jesus. That through that man, we would reign in life. Amplified Bible says it that way. You shall reign in life as kings. Romans 5:17. And in this portion of scripture, it's basically, these are the people that are going to judge. When I have controversy, in controversy, they shall judge, and they will judge my judgments. So he's found a security in a remnant, regardless of their positional title. They prove something to him. And I'm just going to leave this up there for a while. If you can take those notes before I change that page. And if you're watching by Ustream, it would be good to at least write these down, because I got a lot of 1-2-3s, 1-2-3-4s, 1-2-3-5s that are going to go along with all of these. And there's not enough room on that board for all my 1-2-3s. All right? So, like I said, in part one, and I recommend you go back and watch part one. We've had people that watched it. I got emails that they watched it between 7 and 9 times. I guess you would lose count between, was that 7, was that 8, or was that 9? I don't know. That many times, so that was just part one. So there must have been something in there that's ministering life. And so breaking it down, I thought for a third time, it would be expedient, be a blessing for people. Because after all, everything we teach, we expect you to live. We don't expect this to be fancy information that you just learn in your head. So, has everyone had plenty of time? The people on Ustream are all nodding their head, yes? To get these 5 points down before I break it down. Ready? We're going to start with minister to me. There's some important aspects. It says these priests, these Levites, these sons of Zadok, who didn't go astray even when Israel went astray. They stayed close to me. They didn't stray. They shall offer me, they shall come near to me. And I like that because that's intimacy. But minister to me. The fat and the blood. Now we know that the blood is the covering for sin. So they're ministering atonement, they're ministering covering, ministering the fat and the blood. So if we would take this element and put it into a new covenant terminology, basically it's to minister to him is basically to allow the blood to cleanse us of our sin. Because if he cleanses us of our sin, we have fellowship with him and with one another at the same time. That's the blood. The fat is basically, and I kind of like this idea of the fat is basically to restore the glory. Because remember in Romans 3:23 where it says, for all have sinned and what? We don't emphasize that part enough and fall short of the glory. God's intention for us is to reestablish the glory. That's even the purpose of the new birth, is to come back into that glory of the new creation and to know who you are as a new creation. So these are the ones that are going to minister to me. They're going to minister to me the fat and the blood. They're going to basically, and not only come into the glory, but what has to happen to get the glory? And enter into that the glory of the new creation and progressive sanctification. The word that was so real to us during the time I was studying this was one given where, give me your wood, your hay, your stubble, your dead, dry religion, because it burns great. So you want to give him the fat and the blood, and you want to offer something. Give him the hay, the wood, the stubble, because he doesn't want your sacrifices. He wants a ministry to him that is obedience, not sacrifice. Psalm 40, verse 6 in the Amplified. I don't want your sacrifice. My paraphrase. I don't want your sacrifice. I've given you a capacity to hear and obey. So what I'm looking at in this, offering the fat and the blood, this, I want to minister to the Lord himself. And he says, these people who didn't go astray in their heart, these are the people that are going to come near to me. And as they come near to me, there's going to be cleansing for sin, but there's going to be a restoration of the lost glory. That's the purpose of the fat and the blood. To minister to me. To minister to the Lord himself. How many of you, that's a priority? Do you go to God as a priority? Because I'll tell you what, the first step he taught me in the school of the Spirit was, Dennis, the minute you close your eyes, you honor me. And that's a separate topic altogether. That's one of the missing ingredients in the church's honor. And yet God in the school of the Spirit says the first thing you do is you close your eyes, you honor my personhood. Not the Holy Spirit as an it, but as a person. Not the word as letters on a page, but a person. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. And so therefore you honor the Holy Spirit as a person, and in honoring that, you're coming to him to minister to him. And even then he taught me that basically any negative emotion that I had, if all of a sudden I'm loving God and then I think about the foreman at work that I don't like and it goes in here, God basically taught me that reaction is coming between what you and I have together. You cannot minister to me and have aught. No matter how valid the person was, mean, or it was their fault, the point is nothing come between what you and I have together. Because when you treat them as a person, you pay attention to anything that would, and just the way he taught me, nothing grieve, quench, or resist my personhood. Sounds like a pretty good relationship. Husbands, you ought to treat your wives the same way. You don't want to grieve, quench, or resist the relationship. You don't want anything to come between the two of you have together. There's a successful Christian life if you just learn to minister to God, wouldn't it? I mean, you don't have to have deep theology. You do that right, and your steps are going to be ordered of the Lord, and you're going to be blessed. So I saw ministering the fat and the blood to restore the glory of the kingdom. And a lot of that fat is basically some of your sacrifices, your dead works, dead dry religion, because it burns great. Because what are we doing, even in some of our revival services? What do we say? Fire, God, more fire. I want more fire. Well, you know, the best place is put on fire is some of your flesh and your dead religion and your sacrifices, because he's not after your sacrifices. He's after your heart. And what further confirms this is that it said, they will come near to me. They will offer me the fat and the blood. They will come near to my table to minister to me. What was in that table? What was in that table? We're talking in the inner court. This is Sons of Zadok, so it's not New Covenant. That table had the showbread, the candlestick, right? And the third element, incense, altar of incense. Boy, did I spell that wrong. And you know what I always loved about that? If we just took it and made it super simple, I can see mind, will, and emotions there. I can see your mind, will, and emotions being coming before a holy God in the presence. Sure, it's a shadow, but we have the substance. But what does it represent? That light for the mind. Isn't Jesus the light of the world? Aren't we to be sons of light to the Father of lights? That candlestick, as we come and minister before his table, our mind should be illuminated by the very light of God. The incense, that should be our emotions, which were designed by God for God emotions, or this incense should be the sweet fragrance that's coming from our spirit man, New Covenant now, right? The incense, are we not a sweet aroma of life? Then all of that should be representing that we're to be a sweet aroma. Your emotions were made for the fruit of the Spirit. We call them the God emotions. The emotions were not made to be suppressed, depressed, and ignored. Church has taught that. But your emotions were made to be conduits of the fruit of the Spirit. Because we don't want to get to the place where I got the joy of the Lord by faith. That's not faith to me. I got the joy of the Lord by faith. That's not faith. That's presumption. You either have the real thing or your imitation. God didn't ask you to be an imitation. That's dead works, isn't it? And that showbread, the will. Just think, flour was ground fine to make that bread. Finely ground. When your will is finely ground to where it's no longer my will, but thy will be done. I delight to do your will. It's a romance of wills. You should be having, the will is not this religious drudgery. Oh, God's going to have me do something I don't want to do. That's religion. That needs to burn up. Because in the presence of coming near to his table, your will should be a divine romance that I delight to do his will. My will is to finish the work that he gave me to do. I delight to do it. The pleasure of God and the will of God are synonymous. Do you think there's drudgery in heaven where the will of God is being done perfectly? You think there's people sweating? I don't think so. I think, are they working? I believe so. I believe you've got function. But it's going to be a function and a delight to do the will. We're supposed to get it on earth as it is in heaven. But you've got the will represented there. You've got the mind, the illumination, and you've got the beautiful incense of the emotions, because you can fool people with your words, you can fool them with your gestures, but you can't hide what you emanate. And if we're going to teach people to discern, they're going to have to know how to tell, not just by the word, but by the source of the word. And that's what I believe. I believe they've set a beautiful example in shadow anyway of ministering to him the fat and the blood and how to approach that table. How to enjoy mind, will, and emotions in union and communion spiritually with God. Lordship. This is just beautiful lordship. And to further emphasize that table, there's another part. To me, that's beautiful enough. But the other part, it says, they shall come near to my table to minister to me, and they will keep my charge. They shall have linen turbans on their heads and linen trousers, for they shall not clothe themselves with anything that causes sweat. How many think that if it's not an air conditioner failure or you're living in a tropical climate without any heating cooling system type thing, if you're sweating to minister, there's probably a problem there. You shouldn't perspire. It wasn't intended to minister to the Lord and get all sweated up. Now, obviously, there's probably somebody sweating now and they're justifying it. Perhaps there are legal justifications. But in type, it should not be that kind of an effort. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Religion can make you work at it. Religion can make you get into a performance trap. What was the basic, even the basic elementary teaching of Jesus? Repent from dead works, number one. That was the most elementary, fundamental principle. Hebrews 6:1. Repent from dead works, faith toward God, baptism, all of that. Those are fundamental doctrines of Jesus, elementary principles. And what was the first one? Repent from dead works. I'm saying the church is going to have to get back to take the shadow of the beauty of these sons of Zadok and say, how do I apply that under new covenant reality? This is a shadow. I want the reality, and I can have this in Jesus. And I think we got to start there, recognizing if you're sweating and getting all worked up, you're into performance that is not properly based in God, who is at work to will and to perform. You are performing for God as opposed to allowing the anointing to motivate you to perform. Big difference. But that's, again, so it says that they would not cause sweat. They shall teach my people. They shall teach my people the difference between the holy and the unholy. This is where I believe that second element comes in. That second element is basically saying, I'm going to die to sweat or self-imposed religion. And there's another word for it in the King James. You know what the King James called it? Will worship. No, don't we want God to have our will? Sure we do. But it is God who is at work to will and to do. So the question then is, to minister to the Lord effectively, you yield your will to him. And God works. So really, what are we saying? Surrender and obey. And to the point, will worship, I don't know if I even have that scripture, but it's the will worship, I think it's Colossians 2, verses 20 to 23. Colossians 2. And here's what it says. I think I've got King James. Yeah. It says, therefore, if you were dead with Christ, if you died and your life was risen in him, you died from the rudiments of the world. Why, as though living in the world, are you now subject to ordinances? Touch not, taste not, handle not. And I probably step on some sacred cows here, but probably do that all the time anyway, don't even know it. My spiritual father, who's 20 years older than me, told me when I was a baby Christian, the day will come when people will take things that are good and make a religion out of it. Not that they didn't do it then, but he says particularly, and this is how many years ago? This would be 40 years ago. He said they will take things like nutrition, good things. I'm not saying nutrition's bad, but he saw this coming. Touch not, taste not, handle not, and it will have a show of wisdom. Fasting, cleanses. Well, I'm probably making a lot. Oh, I just felt the anointing just dropped in here. Okay. We probably have 9 people on a cleanse here, and I'm all right. Keep it to yourself. Don't tell nobody. But go ahead. It's not on. There it is.
There was an article yesterday in the news that if you cut your salt intake, it increases your risk of a heart attack. It's only in 10% of the population that they should decrease their salt. Most people eat a healthy amount of salt.
Is that amazing? If you've lived as long as we have,
anybody want some popcorn?
We've seen these things flip-flop so many times, you're better off just saying, God, is this good for me or not? It's almost to that extreme, because what they said was bad is now good, and the younger generation's coming up, they just buy whatever's on Facebook. Because if it's on Facebook, it's got to be true, right? Huh? And research, there's the reason we need discernment. There's money behind these statements that people make. Pharmaceutical companies make money with these things. So anyway, I'm not going there with it. But what I'm saying is I'm being careful now that you don't allow something good, like proper nutrition or education. Is an education good? But you don't make a god out of it to the point that it's a distraction from real relationship with Jesus. But I just thought it was interesting. My spiritual father said, you watch, someday they'll be sidetracked with it. That's possible, isn't it? Can you not be sidetracked with something that is in and of itself okay? Sure. But anyway, now that I probably made a few enemies, we're going to work on the rest of us that are still left. If there's anybody left, which are going to perish with the using after the commandments and the doctrines of men, are they not the best of the scientists in this world? Could be wrong. Correct? Even the innocent ones that don't have a bad motive, they could be wrong, because things are flip-flop. But it's basically the commandments and the doctrines of men. I'm not going to have anybody rule my life. You know, wisdom searches out a matter. We need to be asking the Holy Spirit for guidance more than just taking at face value whatever the current trend is, because the world would like to shape you. I would rather basically say, you know what, if I need to stand alone, I'll stand alone. But I'm gonna do the best I can to discern what God has for me individually. Which things have indeed a show of wisdom in will worship. Now, if you saw somebody that was just fasting constantly and everything, that could look very spiritual. And you know what's even stranger? They might be beating their body and just basically looking like they're just holier than thou, and they just might not be holier than thou. They just might be doing a religious function trying to earn favor rather than deepening that divine nature in that relationship. I believe that third element of will worship is basically what God wants to burn up. So we can call for the fire, but I don't have to work up a sweat calling for the fire. I'm going to start offering the fat in me. Any distraction that may be good in and of itself, education, hobbies, I don't care. If it's overpowering beginning to become too much of an obsession, I'm going to surrender it back to God and let him burn it up and bring me into a place of moderation. You know, that's still the biblical key, isn't it? Moderation. That shows Jesus' rule. When you are in moderation, you have the kratos, you have self-control, what the Bible would call the fruit of the Spirit. It's not really self-control, it's God-control, but it's supernatural. It's the fruit of the Spirit of self-control. Now, if that's the case, then there's going to have to be an awareness that one of the enemies during this time is pride. Because the meekness is really the character quality that we're trying to go to in these five elements. That's what I see. I believe God wants his people to be clothed with meekness and humility, right? Humility is grounded in God. Pride is grounded in Satan. The roots are simple. One's rooted in God, one's rooted in Satan. But we've got to slay this pride. Pride is darkness. Pride is death. Pride is disorder. Pride is no purpose. I want to get into that one of these Sundays, because people are struggling with their purpose. When in reality, if they would humble themselves, the the ability to see what God's purposes are for you are made manifest, but they are not made manifest in pride, because he's going to have to bring that pride down first before you will ever see clearly. Pride refuses separation from sin, too, if it's a sinful behavior. There's no real confidence. Pride basically produces a false confidence. Pride inhibits maturity, order, and reproduction. Spiritual pride says, look what happens when I pray, my revelation, my ministry. But those with spiritual pride are drawing attention to themselves, selling and merchandising the gospel. So spiritual pride is a killer. It doesn't matter how great people think you are, if you think you are, right? If you think you are, you will fall, because pride comes before destruction. Spiritual pride lusts after knowledge, but it fails to be a doer of the word. Knowledge puffs up, love edifies, all right? I'm not going to labor that, because the cure is humility and meekness. And spiritual pride causes people to get stuck in a rut. And actually, the verse of scripture that I feel is the sign of the times that we're living in right now is, woe to them. This is Isaiah 5:20. Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. You know what that's saying to me? When I was a young baby Christian, the emphasis was not this. The emphasis was, don't fall in the ditch, Dennis. Don't go off track. Stay on the road. Stay close to Jesus. Now, you can't say fall off the ditch. They don't know what the ditch is and what the road is. That's the transition I've seen. If they don't know what the ditch is and the road, they'll keep you in the ditch and call it the road. That's the kind of times that we're living in. So if ever there was a time when the people of God need to rise up like the sons of Zadok and be non-compromising, but not just dead religious judgmental people, but people that are drawn so close to God that they're ministering to him. He's their portion. He's their reward. They've got spiritual discernment, and they can say, this is holy, this is not holy. Because right now, in the last decade even, if you've been paying attention, there are more heresies in the church in the last 10 years than I've seen in a long time. So that tells you right there, somebody's got to rise up and say, no, that's sin. That's not tolerance. That's not love. That's lust. So I saw and do see that we have two problems with that fallen nature, sin and rebellion. Sin and rebellion. And this is something that I've said in the previous two messages, and I'm going to repeat it because apparently it still needs repeated. We shouldn't just be called believers. We should be called obeyers. Can you see the wisdom in that? Because it demands that spiritual authority, which is basically spiritual authority is the second element that I saw in this portion of scripture. This should be the statement that it's making to us. Spiritual authority is based on who you know and obedience. And what really has been driven home in the last month, and Jennifer and I see these things repeated to us in our prayer time, the thing that's really been driven home was that it's not in your decreeing, in your declarations, in your prayer meetings. That's not the primary thing. The primary way for spiritual authority is to what degree you are known by God. Not by what you say and how you can actually even mimic religious function, but how much are you known by God? Because remember the seven sons of Sceva, they tried to cast out that devil, and what did he say? Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are you? It tells me that you want to be known by God and you want God to know you. Some demon manifests, he wants to know that he can see Jesus in you. So to the degree that you're known, we should be called obeyers. Because salvation deals with the sin and gives us life. You were once dead in sin, and you he made alive. You were dead in trespasses and sin. That's offering the blood. You were dead in trespass and sin. You once walked according to the course of this world. Sounds like you did whatever you wanted to do, right? Wrong. You once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air. You were under control even when you thought you were doing what you wanted to do. You were being swayed and manipulated because you're going to serve somebody. It's either going to be God or the devil, and there's no middle ground. There's no, like we used to say in World War II, there was Switzerland, they remained neutral. There's no neutral. You are either under his control or you are under the sway of the prince of the power of the air, even when you think you're just doing what you want to do. So there's a sin, two problems or failing in meekness, which to me, obedience, even a baby steps of obedience builds authority. So we should be called obeyers, not just believers. It's one thing to believe it. It's another thing to obey. Do you agree? It's more important to be obeyers than just believers. Because we can believe somebody else can do it. Yeah, I believe you can do it. I'm believing for you. Somebody's got to walk in obedience, though. That's the easy way out, believing for someone else. They're the ones that actually has to take the crucible of denying the flesh and going the way of obedience to the Spirit. And they lust against each other. The person saying it, it's not costing you nothing. So, all right, spiritual authority. And you have all five of those memorized now. Here's the problem. I'm believing that what God is taking these sons of Zadok and says, I'm going to bring up a remnant of people, a company of people that's going to walk in meekness. And in that meekness, they're going to have the love of God and the holiness, not just one. Because right now, the deception is love, 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 tolerate everything, even sin. That's what they're doing. And they're calling lust love. They can't discern. Therefore, I believe that where we're at right now is that if God's going to bring up a people that are meek, if he's going to raise them up, there's two things that they've got to overcome. The sin, this is drying up here, of disobedience. And two, the sin of presumption. Disobedience is not doing what you know to do. Presumption is just doing whatever you think because you're tired of waiting for an answer. Do you think people would do that? Mm-hmm. And you know, you can justify a lot of presumption. But you know how you can tell it was presumption? It didn't work, did it? Huh? One of the times that really threw me for a loop, but I never forgot that lesson. Jennifer says, you are so patient waiting for God. Don't you feel like, you know, how do you do that? And I said, well, first I did it wrong once and never forgot. I knew from the time I was a baby Christian, I was to start new works, meaning from scratch. New works from scratch. And then I went to a held Bible study in the engineering department where I worked. And they said, Dennis, you should start a church. All the antenna went up because why? Because that was in my calling. God wasn't telling me this, but the people in the Bible study were telling me. We went and rented a building. 13 of us. Stood in a circle. We were holding hands. We were going to pray. And an authoritative, almost audible voice said, I'm not in this. You only need like one of those embarrassments and humiliations. And I'm going to tell you, I was cured. Years later, and I needed those years later when I started my first church, it took three internationally known prophets to take me to lunch. Pastors, apostles, prophets. Three celebs to take me to lunch and say, Dennis, it's time. So God has a way of getting through to you. But I'll tell you what, it must have taken that, because that lesson of presumption left a lasting, because God can do beautiful stuff like that, and you just think that, well, he's not doing it, so I better help him out. I'm telling you what, I see way too much presumption in the younger generation. If you're called to ministry, you're called to business, you're called to a kingdom purpose, you try to make it happen, and it has to fall apart. It has to fall apart if that's the only way you could learn. I would rather obey. I would rather not enter into disobedience, and I would rather not get presumptuous. Now, if God does that, then basically we're not doing what God said to do. It's a sin of disobedience. Doing something apart from God, which he didn't tell us to do, or we're making it fit into something he told us to do. So we need to be obeyers, not just believers. But ultimately, that's the way God's going to establish his kingdom. All right? So where are we at? Spiritual authority. I also believe, too, that when it comes to spiritual authority, there's a difference between dimensional authority and directional authority. There's probably an easier way to say this. You know what I mean by dimensional authority? Was like the Apostle Paul said in Galatians 1. He says, "It pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb, called me through his grace to reveal his son in me that I might preach." It needs to be in that order. To reveal his son in me to preach. Preach was secondary. Reveal his son in me was the primary dimensional revelation. You need, Jesus learned obedience by the things that he suffered. For 3 years of ministry, he had 30 years of life under his belt. God made the man before he makes the ministry. And I see an impatience in that area. I'm saying what's needed more now is mothers and fathers to come alongside, not discourage them, but encourage them to do it right. Save them from some of the hardships of presumption in the name of zeal, because there's a zeal of the Lord and there's the zeal of the flesh. As a matter of fact, the first word that God taught me, because I was zealous for God and whenever I wanted, a prophetess came one time and was laughing as she prayed over me and said, "Dennis, God loves your spirit, but you're going to have to change. You've got Jesus by the hand and you're dragging him around telling him what he's going to do next." It's not going to work that way. You're going to follow him. And it was like crushing. That's the way I learned, though. Crushing, and then you don't forget it. And it makes the next time much better. And not only did he do that, but he basically said that in the zeal, it came from the Greek word zeloi, Z-E-L-O-I, which meant listen to this, because you need this written on the tablet of your heart. He told me that zeal of the flesh was an uncurbed, that means out of control, an uncurbed rivalry spirit in business or religion. An uncurbed rivalry, competitive spirit in business or religion, zeloi, zeal. Emulation would be the King James word, emulate, to mimic, but it was basically an unhealthy, sometimes it's even translated, that same word is translated, jealousy, okay? But it's basically, what are you doing when you're jealous? You want something that somebody else has. Is that competitive or what? Are you competing? Yeah. So God basically says, but Paul had his Damascus Road experience, and the first thing he said, "It pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb to reveal his son in me that I might preach." Now, his emphasis, and we know this of Paul, Paul's emphasis, "Oh, how I labor again that Christ be formed in you." He wasn't talking about their gifts or callings. We emphasize gifts and callings. Paul emphasized Christ being formed in you. I labor that Christ being formed in you. to reveal his son in you. But he was not slack in doing what God said, because in Acts 26, in telling King Agrippa about his Damascus Road experience, he said, I said, who are you, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus, whom you're persecuting. That would get my attention. I don't know about you. And he said, rise, which means he fell. Rise and stand on your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to make you a minister and a witness, both of the things which you have seen and of the things that I have yet to show you. You know what? There's some things that God has yet to show you. Are you obedient to what he has showed you? Don't expect more if you won't do the last thing he said. That's the way we minister to people, too. If they didn't do their homework, they didn't do the last thing we said, don't make another appointment. What's the use? You haven't done the last thing, right? These things which I will yet reveal to you, I will deliver you from the Jewish people as well as from the Gentiles to whom I now send you. For what purpose? This is the external. To open their eyes in order to turn them from darkness to light. But you better know the difference, right? You better have his son revealed in you. Before I tell you to do something, you've got to be competent and able to do it. God is able. His word is able, and you are able if you pursue him in obedience, not in theory. So he says, I've called you to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God, that they might receive forgiveness of their sins and an inheritance among those who are sanctified. And there's that inheritance. Inheritance among those who are set apart by me. Their satisfaction is in knowing him. It's a relationship. It's not about just doing. It's about a relationship. Being trumps doing. The doing needs to flow out of what is real on the inside. Real ministry is an overflow of the legitimacy of the intimacy that's in you. And it's our obedience that the kingdom gets established. Because first, authority is set in Jesus himself. Make Jesus be Lord. Second, he needs to be Lord in the church, in the corporate setting. Not just Savior, Lord. Third, then impact the world. That's what's going to change the world. That's the kingdom message. Through our obedience, the kingdom shall go to the world. Now, spiritual authority versus positional authority, to know and be known. God basically brings us to the third element. From the place of spiritual authority, we move to and this is the word of the Lord for Dennis and Jennifer. This is a mandate God's given us, so you will be hearing about this whenever. But I can't make it happen, but I know that this is my focal point. Teach them to discern. And before God said it to me, he got me the way he usually gets me. He gets me to make observations by discernment of how lacking discernment is. But real discernment does not just see the problem. Real discernment has to see the redemptive solution. Real discernment sees more God than evil. And this is what I believe we're going to be doing. We're going to be endeavoring to do it. Actually, Jason said it this way. Jason, my son, has better discernment than anybody I've run into in ministry for 40 years. Second only to me. I had to throw that in there to keep him humble. All right. But if we would teach the body to discern, This is going to destroy some sacred cows. We're going to get sick and tired of hearing about Sister So-and-so's got a Jezebel spirit, an Ahab spirit, Absalom spirit, and everything. Those things would stand out like a sore thumb. Real discernment is going to see, I see the apostle inside that man. I see the prophet. I see the man of character and meekness. I see the gold. Real discernment sees more gold than jerk. Black stuff. Darkness. Any idiot can be a fault finder. You don't even have to be saved. Couldn't you go around and just look at people and find fault? I mean, that's like so easy. Don't call it discernment. Real discernment sees the legitimate. It should see more gold in the person's life. And then, yes, do you see as a byproduct the dirt? Absolutely. The closer you get to Jesus, the dirt stands out in contrast readily. But you don't pride yourself that you see what's wrong. You take redemptive love. Matter of fact, just the scripture verse that could really just unfold this whole thing is Philippians 1:9, 1:8. Am I right? Philippians 1:8, 1:9. Let your love abound. What does that mean? Let love overflow in all real knowledge. What's real knowledge? Not head knowledge. Reality. Jesus. That portion. It is 1:9. Philippians 1:9. Let the love in here, the love of Jesus in here. Love precedes peace. And from that rule of God, let the peace of God rule. From the rule of God or the peace of God, you discern. You do not discern when you're not out of the love of God or the peace of God. You don't know what you're talking about. What you're calling discernment usually is something that irritates you. Somebody irritates you and you're down here. You know what that means? You're letting something coming between you and God. I don't care how bad they are. That is coming between you and God, and you don't discern nothing when you're, you know what, when you get that, and you see somebody that's doing something wrong, you know what that means? It means you're the same as they are. You picked it up. You got evangelized by them. They were angry, and you got mad. What's the difference? What's the difference? Their spirit won you over. Who evangelized who? And then what do? You get into pride and say, they've got a bitter spirit. All right, where's the redemption? Where's the love? Where's the solution? Where's the Jesus in that? What do? Just write them off? Take them out back and shoot them? It's not a bad idea sometimes. Teach them to discern. Look at these sons of Zadok. Basically, what did they do? They've got to learn. Here's what God's looking for. A company of people that have enough discernment that no matter how bad society gets, you are not evangelized by that society. You recognize, you know what? They're telling you to be tolerant of what is unholy. If you don't learn to draw the line, the God is love and God is holy. You can't throw away the holy and just use that word love. God is love. Love is not God. Think about that one for a while. Because God is love and holy. You know what? I love to teach on prejudice too, because people are calling it discernment when in reality, no, you've made it, it doesn't fit your theology. I can remember ministering one time and the person I was praying for, the Holy Spirit increased and they went flying. And I felt the anointing do it. I've also felt when people threw themselves down. So it's not the action. It's the motive or the source. Real discernment goes to the source. But while that person went flying, a Baptist minister here, no offense to the Baptist, but for him, that was against his theology. And when that guy went flying, I felt the anointing flowing. I felt the hovering presence of the Spirit of God on him. And over here, I felt, So what was his doing? It was violating, but that was a prejudice. It was not the same as what we would call a bad witness. His so-called bad witness was based on his theology that that's not God from up here. You follow? So I approached it this way. I said, you got a bad witness on that. He said, I certainly did. And I said, by what faculty did I know that you had a bad witness on that when I was totally comfortable in the peace of God with that? What faculty did I use? If I discerned his bad witness and I didn't have a bad witness. See, and he couldn't answer that. And I says, in fact, if you have a prejudice theologically, the wise thing to do would be, I don't know. Wisdom will search out the matter and say, Holy Spirit, teach me. There are many a Baptist who got filled with the Holy Spirit because they didn't get rigid. They said, God, if that's you, show me. That is the proper approach. Wisdom is, first of all, pure. When the heart is pure, you will grow in your discernment. When the heart is pure, the wisdom that comes from above is first pure, then peaceable. It can't be judgmental or prejudiced. If it's judgmental or prejudiced and you're calling it a bad witness, can you see why we need to teach discernment? Because we have a tendency to go by what we read and what we hear in our heads and take it as, well, that's what that person said, that's what they mean. I'd rather go and train people to say, hear what they said, read what they wrote, and then go with your gut.
So the problem was...
Are you... Hold on. Go ahead.
So the problem was he was not sensitive to recognize the anointing, and that's something that... that I've seen, that so many believers will argue theology, but if they could feel whether there's an anointing on something or whether it's unclean or demonic, it would answer all the questions.
However, if they stay in their head, even full gospel people, if they stay in their head, Kenneth Hagin had a very sharp remark, so I always use his name there instead of me saying it. I have enough enemies. I create enough, burn up enough sacred cows, but... Kenneth Hagin said, most Christians wouldn't recognize the Holy Spirit if he was wearing a red baseball cap and tennis shoes. That kind of sarcasm was necessary to get people to say, maybe I better inquire a little bit deeper. Maybe I come to a lot of conclusions. Wherever there is a blank, I fill it with an opinion. That's the easy road. That's not searching God. It's the wisdom of a king to search out a matter. And if we would search more diligently, there'd be a whole lot more Jesus we would know. But it's just too easy to fill in the blanks with an opinion. And an opinion can actually stand in the way of further knowledge, spiritual knowledge.
And end up blaspheming the Holy Spirit by calling the Holy Spirit the devil.
That's the one that concerns Jennifer. Do you know how readily in charismatic circles, if something doesn't quite sit with them right, they call it the devil? New Age or the devil, you better just bite your tongue until God has shown you for sure. Because you look on Facebook, and the obvious difference of opinions is there's a whole lot that are wrong. I would be afraid for them to be calling things New Age or the devil when it's the Holy Spirit. Why not plead ignorance and humble yourselves and say, God, teach me. Teach me to know right from wrong. Teach me if there's areas of the Holy Spirit. Don't give me this, I've been around, I've taken the course, I know everything there is to know. Those are the people that are going to really suffer in the latter days. It's because you can't teach somebody that already knows everything. There's nothing left.
And actually, Jesus called it blaspheming the Holy Spirit. And he said, every sin that you commit against the Son of Man will be forgiven. But the one sin that won't be forgiven in this world or the next is blaspheming the Holy Spirit, calling the Holy Spirit the devil. That's pretty scary.
Here's the fourth element. Their satisfaction is in me. It's like Abraham said, I'm going to have them teach the people what is holy and what is not holy. Teach them to discern. Teach the people to discern. That's where the Lord really was preaching to us. That you can discern, Dennis, doesn't help anybody except whoever you might help. Teach them to discern more efficiently, because under the new covenant, you have an anointing that abides within, and you shouldn't need anyone to teach you. The Holy Spirit in you is more than willing. We should be coaching people to allow the Holy Spirit in you to teach you more in the ways of discernment, drawing a closer relationship. That's equipping as opposed to being an expert. And what you will find is that the satisfaction in Him, when you really find your satisfaction in Him and you apply discernment better, you're also going to be embarrassed at the fact that you don't have the spiritual warfare all your friends do. I am absolutely, thoroughly convinced a good portion, not all, a good portion of spiritual warfare are people's unresolved emotional conflicts. Their carnality is beating them up. They've got a sign on them, kick me. I mean, I'm embarrassed at these people that basically have very little victory in their life and they're always under spiritual warfare. Why would the devil pick on you? You don't have any victory in your life as it is. You're not a threat. There's such a thing as spiritual warfare. I'm balancing this out only because I'm saying unnecessary trials and tribulations. Unnecessary. And there could be an element of pride there to want to call it spiritual warfare rather than humble yourself and deal with your internal issues. If you don't win the battle within, you're not going to be very effective winning the battle without. I've said this for many, many years, probably decades now. Whenever I first heard of the Seven Mountain, I said, if you don't win the seven internal mountains, you're not going to be of any value in those seven mountains, wherever you are assigned. The seven internal mountains need the lordship of Jesus. Otherwise, you'll be corrupted in any of those mountains. They'll evangelize you, and your pride will probably help cripple you. Finding the satisfaction in God, you're also going to find out that He that dwells in the secret place, that's where that satisfaction, ye that dwells in that secret place shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. That the arrow might fly by day and night, but it's not going to touch you. You can't touch the fruit of the Spirit. So does that mean there won't be spiritual warfare? No. But does it mean, it's like Jesus said, be of good cheer. In this world you will have tribulation. The Message says, in this world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I've overcome its ability to harm you. So who cares if you get in the battle if it doesn't harm you? Hurt but not harm. There's a big difference between hurt and harm. Fiery darts get quenched. Isn't that the purpose of it? Doesn't mean no fiery darts. It means the fiery darts get quenched. That's victorious living. We're not saying no warfare. And lastly, they shall stand as judges. In other words, I see them as mature mothers and fathers that are going to help keep people on track in times of controversy. Because right now, there are quality, gifted people that still have some need to hear from some older people some common sense solutions, or what we would call common sense, but really it could be cumulative wisdom over the years, things that we learned the hard way. It's not necessarily wisdom that falls from above like a revelation. It's the wisdom, you know, been there, done that, that doesn't work. Here, try this. Huh? Because so many of those things that they think are a revelation, guess what? We've heard that, been there, done that. There's a right way to do it and there's a wrong way to do it. My dad said the most irritating thing in the engineering department were the ones coming right out of college, out of engineering, and they had these ideas that, and my dad said, we tried that in 1929, it didn't work. They tried that in 1940 and it didn't work. We tried that in 1950 and it didn't work. So there's room for innovative and the new, but there's also the wisdom of the ages where there are concrete, stable things that don't change, just like Jesus, right? So regardless of what society is saying, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. There's a stability in there. And that's where we come to the place of adjudication. You know, when I say the word judge, I'm talking about reigning in life as kings. One of the things that we've seen that was beneficial is our pastoral staff there. We've got 9 of us that meet. And I can remember when Jason came, that one of the most beneficial things that Jason came was recognizing that 7 people did not think some of the thoughts that he was thinking in those early days, and that helped stabilize. You know, if you got around healthy people, it's really good for you. Get around, just because when you isolate yourself, get what do? You get crazy thoughts in your head. You're bouncing them off of who? You. So a man who isolates himself seeks his own desire. A scary place to be. But people are afraid that accountability might mean sickly dependence. No. Sickly dependence is needs to be dealt with. We don't want anybody sickly dependence. But what we did is said, you know what we need? We need to renew our vows with Jesus. We need to say, I do. And the easy way to remember it is, we need intimacy, greater dependency, and obedience. Greater intimacy, greater dependence. And I had to learn that dependence thing the hard way because I was raised the opposite. I was raised in South Chicago that the sooner you were free of mom and dad, the more mature you were. I was 9 years old. And I didn't want my dad to go in the store with me because my friends would think I was a sissy. At 9, that's imposed by the culture. First job, age 10, that was maturity, responsibility. But then I get saved and God said, it's the opposite in the kingdom. It's greater dependency, not independence. Independence is not a sign of maturity. It's a sign of maturity is when you can basically be interdependent, so healthy you're ready for corporate life. All right? So here's the last 4. If God were to create such a people, if a remnant would rise up and be this meek people that are drawing nigh to God to minister to him first and foremost. Here's the way it would show. They would be easily approachable. And I'm only using that word approachable, spirit to spirit. Them and Jesus, communion, connecting spirit to spirit would be normative. To disconnect would be abnormal for them. And how do we reconnect if we do disconnect? Forgiveness, repentance, it's a beautiful ability to reconnect. You stay connected. The opposite of pride is someone that you can approach spirit to spirit. In other words, know somebody according to the spirit, not according to the flesh. Because most people just judge people according to the flesh. They judge them by their personality, by their actions. You can fool people with your words and you can fool them with your gestures, but you can't hide what you emanate. We've got to raise up a people who discern by the Spirit. And when they close their eyes, they're in the presence of God. When their eyes are open, they're in the presence of God. They're connecting spirit to spirit easily. It's not something they've got to labor. I can't stay dropped down. I tried to drop down, but I can't. All of that makes absolutely no sense to me. That means your carnality is ruling. You haven't brought it under yet. It should be as easy as breathing to be in a spirit-to-spirit relationship with your Jesus. The second element and actually, my son Jason could do this from age 6 on. He was saved at 5 and a half, and from age 6 now. Never miss, or not never, instead of putting never, a better way to say this, would feel, which is really discern, the slightest movement in somebody's spirit. Is that intimidating? How many think that's a little intimidating? Let me show you where you've already done it. How many have ever witnessed to somebody and told them about Jesus and you felt like the words were falling down? That is not intellect. Only your spirit has the capacity to perceive that. You knew they weren't open. You knew they had a wall. Even if you didn't know what a wall was, you knew. How many ever witnessed to somebody and it felt like a vacuum cleaner was pulling the words out? Huh? So don't tell me you can't discern. You just didn't develop it. But I've never run into anybody that hadn't experienced that. Right? So that means you could develop it because you have an anointing within and you shouldn't need anyone to teach you, but you do need to pursue God and ask and inquire and require as a vital necessity for Him to teach you the things that He wants to teach you in the kingdom of God. Nobody's going to, people can coach you, but ultimately it's the Holy Spirit in you that's going to teach you. You have to avail yourself and get out of that arrogant, proud head of yours, because most of your success and achievement has been because of what you did up here. You want to stay like that? Fine. There's a lot of intelligent people. There's geniuses up there making stupid, life-changing, life-altering damage with that brilliant mind of theirs. So I would humble that proud mind and say, Holy Spirit, teach me. I've got the equipment that everybody else has. God is able. You made me able. You gave me the equipment, and your word is able, and your Holy Spirit is able. Teach me. I want to start learning a new way. I'm ready for a new plan. Working with my mind, if I'm going to stay working with my mind and proud of my achievements and my mental ability, then I'm always going to need somebody a little more clever than me to keep me interested. But if it's the depths of Jesus, you can plumb those the rest of your life. You're going to be in heaven, and He's going to go, holy, holy, holy. You're going to be constantly, even in heaven, filled with revelation of more of Him. So don't think you've arrived. That's impossible. But get to the point where you want to feel the slightest move in another person's spirit. Just like I said, just like that man over there. I could feel what the anointing was doing here, and I could feel that. You should be able to do the same thing. You could learn to do this. This is not for gifted, highly gifted people. This is for any believer who has chosen to develop it. God took me to the school of the Spirit and just happened to not do it the Bible school way. He did it His way to me. And what He basically said was, anything unpleasant in the seat of the emotions is coming between what you and I have together. If you would approach it as a love relationship, and that anything yucky in your life is coming between you and Jesus, and you learn to deal with that, your discernment would skyrocket. But if that doesn't mean that much to you, you want to do what you want to do the way you want to do it, that's too boring, you've got people to see and places to go, well, then, but don't say that that potential is not in you, that that's only for gifted people, because that's a lie. God's going to raise up sons of Zadok, and mature people, who are going to teach my people to discern, because right now, look at it. Look at the church. They're not discerning very well. At least 50% are wrong on an opposing view, right? God said this, and God said no, no. God said this, God said no, no. Well, guess what? At least 50% show you that they're really hurting in their discernment. And the other half might be guessing right. How many are really discerning? How many are really that intimate with God that they've got such a word that they would give their life for it? The third element, make that your goal. I don't want to miss a move in the spirit, in another person's spirit. Why? To be nosy or judgmental? No, to know how to redemptively minister to them accordingly. I mean, I dismiss most of what I pick up in the spirit. I can tell when I'm wearing the crowd out. It starts to go like this because they're trying to understand it up here too much and they're getting tired. You're supposed to be no sweat. You're supposed to be listening right here, drinking it in. Drink it in here because your spirit has a capacity. Our problem with the church is we've got big, big heads and itsy bitsy spirits. Learn to drink it from here and take it in. The third element, and this one, I don't know if we need an awakening before I can see a better response on this one. Touch the spirit of the body. I still see most of the church as a crowd. They still do not necessarily have a concept of family. For I place the solitary in family. Some people don't know where they live, where they belong, what they do for a living. They're disoriented, but they're believers. One of the signs of real meekness is you touch the spirit of the body. It would be like, not just with your gifts, but it would be like if Molly there was sitting and Christy over here was hurting and not making any outward display that you're hurting, but just bleeding on the inside. When you really touch and really care and you really love the body the way Jesus wants you, you will have people that will pick up on that person that's hurting. That's the by your spirit, not because they go, I have a prayer request, with, you know, that people that have financial problems that go, I just thank you, Jesus. I know you're going to meet my needs to pay my gas bill of $46.29 by next week. That's not a prayer request. That's begging, all right? But when someone by the Spirit walks up and knows that they're hurting financially, they're hurting emotionally, and they bear witness to that, that's someone who's ready for corporate life. Most in the body are a crowd. But I believe that we're getting to the place where it's going to be like Jesus said, this is my mother, my brother, and my sisters, they who do the will of God from the heart. I see people caught up in their own little agendas. The saddest story was, remember the man that said, God spoke to me almost in an audible voice, I'm supposed to come to your church, but I have a Bible study with five men, and I can't leave it. I'd be embarrassed to tell anybody that. That was more important to him, that need to be needed, than obedience to God. Isn't that scary? I mean, like I said, that might exist, but most people would keep that to themselves. They wouldn't be so blunt. Man, if God ever tells you to obey and quit trying to figure it out, quit thinking, what's in it for me? But when you touch the spirit of the body, you'll be in the right place at the right time. Pride can't handle that. Pride will be afraid someone will be in my way of my gift. Pride will say, what's in it for me? Pride will say, somebody's replacing me. Pride will say, I don't think it's not. The five C's, the five deadly C's. Complain. Compete. Compare. Covet. And conceal. All of those are deadly to your calling and to your ministry. And the very first sermon that I preached to, it was a congregation of 1,100 people, and I was a totally unknown, that my spiritual father went by the Spirit, found me, when all I was doing was praying that I'm going to support him, but he's never going to know that I exist. And out of 1,200 people, he found me, and he says, you're going to preach next Sunday. I preached next Sunday what I would have considered an unknown. And I preached the five C's of a communicator. These are the wrong five C's. The five C's of a communicator. My first sermon 40 years ago. And somehow God must have in humbling myself to serve him without making any notice toward myself, God basically said, you're going to learn to commune or you don't have anything to say. If you're not with him, you don't have anything worth saying. I don't care how well you know your Bible. If you haven't heard anything, you don't have anything worth saying. Whatever you communicate needs to come out of your communion. Secondly, if it comes out of that communion, you're going to see it convert lives. I don't mean just salvation. I mean it's going to have an effect on people's lives to transform them. It will convert them. If it doesn't have converting ability, it's just more information for their head. If it doesn't challenge their spirit, if it doesn't convert, the third C of a communicator. This is any believer, a communicator. What are you communicating? It's the life that you live. It's not just the words that you speak. The highest form of communication is to reveal him. Remember, Paul said that I was taken from my mother's womb to reveal his son in me to preach. He didn't say I was called from my mother's womb to preach. I was called from my mother's womb to reveal his son in me that I might preach. That has to come out of communion. That will have converting power for either salvation or sanctification. The third one was, if it's substance, it will create a desire. You won't have to beat people over the head to want it. It will create a desire. Just like a midwife, if they had a baby in the times of Israel, if the baby wouldn't suck, the mother would put oil on her finger and massage the baby's palate to tease it or train it, they would call. Train it or tease it to create a desire to want. A communicator creates a desire to want more. And you don't have to do a song and dance and work up a sweat to get them to do it. The fourth element is a real communicator. If it's substance, if it's coming from Jesus, if it's got life-changing power, if it's going to create a desire, they will somehow know by the Spirit, not just by outward appearance, these people care. It'll be a caring zeal that is not flesh zeal. It's not emulation. It's not an uncurbed rivalry spirit in business or religion. That care is a loving care, and you will feel it in the spirit. And I think sometimes it even translates as trust. Some people just say, you know what, I don't know why, but I just think I trust you. That's a lot of times they feel like, you know what, I feel like I would get what Jesus has for me, not their agenda. And the fifth element, it will construct, it will build something. God's whole plan is to build us up, to get us rooted and grounded and built up as a habitation of God. If it doesn't build anything, I mean, this is why I can't even understand. I can't understand liberals and conservatives, to tell you the truth, because conservatives are trying to build something. And it seems like liberals are always tearing it down. I mean, if it doesn't construct something, socialism doesn't build anything. It destroys. So to me, a communicator has to be building something. And aren't we supposed to be expanding the kingdom of God? And weren't we created unto good works that were preordained before the foundation of the earth? So those are the five C's of a communicator. I'm just throwing that in. That's not necessarily in this teaching, but I liked it. That was my first sermon. John the Baptist, he converted, didn't he? Repent for the kingdom of heaven. That change, right? There had to be a conversion of some sort. There had to be a change of the entire mindset for it to work. So I hope that helped clarify all of the times that I went 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, and nobody knows what I was talking about. So if you've been able to stay through Zadok Priesthood 1, Zadok Priesthood 2, and Zadok Priesthood 3, now it should make sense tonight. If it doesn't make sense tonight, you'll have to listen to it again and again and again. All right? Let's go back and close by reading the original mandate. Ezekiel 44, 15 to 28. But the priests, the Levites, the sons of Zadok, who kept my charge of my sanctuary, I think my battery is low. Okay. But read this 44. You can read this for yourself in your Bibles, but it's basically in case I cut out here. But they will come near to me to minister to me. They will stand and offer the blood and the fat. They will come near to my table to minister to me. They shall wear linen because I don't want sweat. I don't want dead works. Anything that causes sweat. They will teach my people the difference between that which is holy and that which is unholy. They will cause them to discern between the clean and the unclean, and they shall stand as judges in the times of controversy. We need mothers and fathers that can help the young people in times of the gray areas is where they struggle. Many of the young believers are pursuing God with all their heart, with a passion, but at the same time in the gray areas, the world it pulls with their opinion, and they're weighing out and wondering, how stable is that? Maybe it needs to change. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And they need to come alongside and say, you need stabilized on the proper foundation. Get out of the ditch. This is the road. Stay on it. Because I'm a firm believer that mothers and fathers, there's going to be a tremendous harvest. But boy, if we don't have some sons of Zadok rising up and saying, this is holiness. As a matter of fact, this is the way we taught even discernment. Because they try to use the way there was a young girl that was hitting on other girls and using churchianity, saying, well, don't you hug? So you don't get into a mental argument. You go to the discerner and say, yes, but I feel it's unclean. Somebody's got to tell the difference between the clean and the unclean. Somebody's got to set a standard that's spiritual and not intellectual and argumentative. And that solved it in that particular case. And that I believe the day's coming when we're going to need that more and more, especially in the last decade with all of the overflow of heresies. Okay. For all of those that I did not wear out, stand up and stretch. Thank you. Father, we thank you. Seal this work by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.
Did you know that we have an online school available? Hi, I'm Pastor Jason Clark. We invite you to join our international community of almost 1,000 students currently enrolled in a school like no other. Team Embassy equips believers to live in the Spirit by giving them the how-to tools for wholeness, intimacy with God, and living the abundant life Jesus promised us. You will learn how to heal emotional pain quickly and completely. You'll discover amazing keys to tap into the fruit of the Spirit and practice the presence of God as a lifestyle. Exciting courses available include the 60-Day Challenge, Self-Deliverance, Healing Rejection, Codependency, Intimate Prayer, The Functions of the Human Spirit, and many, many more. It's formatted so that you could take it with you on all your mobile devices. Sign up today at training.teamembassy.com. Be transformed. Become all God created you to be. You will never be the same.